This is Duke University.
Thank you. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We welcome you this morning to this service of worship here at Duke Chapel. We extend a special greeting to any of you who are here for the first time today. We pray that you will encounter God here today and in many days to come. If you don't already know this, you will come to find pretty quickly that the bulletin is one of your best information resources around this place. Not only will it guide you through our worship service each Sunday, it will also provide you with a plethora of interesting and informational announcements and opportunities of ways to be involved here at the chapel. Now, I trust that all of you will go home and spend your hours of free time this afternoon poring through its pages just so you can know every single opportunity. One thing you may find as you're looking through the bulletin is that next week, following the worship service, the congregation and members of the congregation will be outside on the front lawn to share with you information about the ministries that we have for the congregation. We hope that you will stay and learn about all the interesting ways that God is at work in and among and through us. Another thing that you will find in your bulletin if you are taking time to look through it is that our Monday morning prayer this week will be held on Tuesday because of the holiday. Something that is not in this week's bulletin, but that will no doubt be interesting to university students, is that last week's Loco Pops on the Lawn was a raving success. And we decided if it was good once, it would be good again. And so we invite any university student following worship to come out to the front lawn and have a Loco Pop and meet some new people and meet the chapel staff. Now let us worship the living God. Please stand.
We confess our sins to God, not for our flogging, but for our flourishing. We trust that God's love enfolds us and upholds us to lead us in. And so we ask Him to free us from the sins that so easily mislead us. Let us now confess those sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and but what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. God, the Father of mercies, has reconciled the world to himself through the death and resurrection of his Son, Jesus Christ, not counting our trespasses against us, but sending us his Holy Spirit to shed abroad his love among us. By the ministry of reconciliation entrusted by Christ to his church, receive his pardon and peace, stand before him in his strength alone, this day and evermore, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. You may be seated. Now let us share with one another words and signs of peace we have received in Christ.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Merciful God, your Son came to save us and bore our sins on the cross. Inspire us as we hear your word today. May we trust in your mercy and know your love, rejoicing in the righteousness that is ours through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Jeremiah, the 18th chapter. Dean Wells will be preaching from this text. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, "Come, go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words." So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel, as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me, "Can I not do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done?" says the Lord. "Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. At one moment I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will pluck up and break down and destroy it. But if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will change my mind about the disaster that I intended to bring on it. And at another moment, I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will build and plant it. But if it does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, then I will change my mind about the good that I had intended to do to it. Now, therefore, say to the people of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, look, I am a potter shaping evil against you and devising a plan against you. Turn now, all of you, from your evil way and amend your ways and your doings." This is the word of the Lord.
I want you.
The New Testament lesson is from Paul's letter to Philemon, the first chapter. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith towards the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I preferred to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but as more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from Luke, the 14th chapter. Now, large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, "This fellow began to build and was not able to finish." Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then, while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can be my disciple if you do not give up all of your possessions. This is the word of the Lord.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please sit down. Not long after my sister began life as an undergraduate, she had a high noon meeting with her roommate and the dorm housekeeper. My sister had been on a couple of dates, and she'd seen just about enough. Men, she expostulated. Her roommate shared my sister's exasperation and bewilderment. "We should shoot them all and have done with it," she concluded. The housekeeper interjected in a kindly but experienced tone, "Don't waste your energies, my lovelies. They're not worth the bullets." The last 6 years have witnessed the publication of a series of books from a variety of authors attacking religion with a virulence not seen for a long time. This movement has been called the New Atheism. It believes religion should no longer be tolerated, but should be exposed, challenged, and refuted at every opportunity, with a conviction founded on scientific certainty. I haven't referred to these antagonists in sermons from this pulpit because I've taken the advice of my sister's housekeeper and reckoned that the work of Christopher Hitchens, Sam Harris, Daniel Dennett, and others was not worth the bullets, my lovelies. The New Atheists have said many new things and many true things, but the new things they've said are not true, and the true things they've said are not new. I'm making an exception this morning for three reasons. One is that in almost every Christian who's been around a university like ours, there's a lingering anxiety, maybe even dread, that perhaps science really has disproved it all. Maybe I'm talking about you. A second is that the most famous of the new atheists, Richard Dawkins, will be giving a lecture at Duke in a month's time. The third reason is that it's been my habit each year on opening Sunday to reflect with you on a major question in the life of the university. Today, I want to dwell on the place of science in our common life. The prophet Jeremiah describes God as a potter handling and cherishing the clay and making something beautiful out of it when it's been deformed or damaged. The Christian life begins when we realize that we are that clay. But today, I want to see how Jeremiah and his picture of God as a potter might inspire us to handle precious things the same way God cherishes us. The relationship between science and theology is like clay. It's moist and full of potential, and if cherished, should become something beautiful. But currently, this clay is spoiled in our hands. The relationship between science and theology seems less about understanding and more about bullets. I want to suggest a refashioning of the relationship of science and theology, and in doing so, to explain why I believe each being part of the one university is a blessing that we can all celebrate. To understand the backlash of some prominent intellectuals against religion, one has to scroll back a few decades. The new atheists came to adulthood in a world where it was assumed that an atheism inspired by the discoveries of science would soon fill the earth as surely as the waters cover the sea. 23 years ago, the movie-going public was captivated by a movie called Fatal Attraction, which portrays a professional woman having a wild weekend affair with a man while the man's wife is out of town, and then obsessively stalking him for months afterwards. Her activities become increasingly alarming until finally she breaks into the man's house in murderous mood. The man fights her off and forces her into the bathroom, where she becomes submerged beneath the surface of the bathwater for several minutes. Her body goes limp, blood rises from the corner of her mouth, and the man and his wife finally relax. But the stalker defies apparent death, and in a scene rated number 59 in Bravo's scariest movie moments, she rises up from the bathwater to mount one final deranged but ultimately unsuccessful attack. This is how the new atheism sees religion. Given up for dead 40 years ago, it's rising anew from the bathtub, like a scary scene from a movie. Reports of its death have been greatly exaggerated, and it's not only alive but unhinged and eager to fight. The dismay of making such a baffling discovery in large part accounts for the almost hysterical tone adopted by some of the new atheist arguments. The first thing to say in response to these assaults is that Christianity has only itself to blame for being criticized in such a way. Most people who reject faith as vehemently as this do so not on scientific grounds, but on moral ones. While the portrayal of Christianity offered by the new atheists is an absurd caricature to most Christians, there are undoubtedly some who sincerely hold the lurid views Dr. Dawkins and his friends take to be the norm. We Christians have often propounded an impoverished faith and have even more frequently failed to live up to the faith we profess. So we are bound to invite criticism from those who scrutinize our lives and convictions. At the same time, just because we're often poor witnesses to our beliefs, that doesn't thereby mean our beliefs are untrue. The novelist Evelyn Waugh used to ask, "Do you think that I'm not much of a person, given that I claim to be a Christian?" Then he'd chuckle and add, "Imagine what I'd be like if I weren't a Christian." The relationship between theology and science can't be left to extremists who believe that only one or the other can make legitimate claims. Instead, it must begin with respect and awe. Natural science has plausibly been called the most successful enterprise human beings have ever engaged upon. The more that science discovers about life, the universe, and about the tiniest detail and the mightiest power, the more one can only be amazed and enthralled. Yet if one has awe towards the known, one must have at least equal awe towards the unknown. That awe is not always in high profile. In 1928, the German Nobel physicist Max Born announced that physics as we know it will be over in 6 months. 1928. It turned out not to be so. The only trustworthy science is a humble science, which acknowledges the tentativeness of the known and the vast extent of the unknown. But the same is true of theology. There's so much that remains unknown, and claiming to know more than we do, especially if it's done with a hectoring tone and without a listening ear, substitutes arrogance and ignorance for true faith and attracts the antagonism it deserves. And that's why it's such a blessing for science and theology to belong in a university alongside one another. Some believe universities are all about natural science, and there should be no place for literature or philosophy, let alone religion, because they have no testable data and refuse to play by the rules. Some few believe that theology is the queen of the sciences, and that the findings of science should be filtered through the truths of faith, because theological questions of why always precede scientific questions of how. But the privilege of being a university community means that students and faculty can enjoy and benefit from the different methodologies of the respective disciplines, valuing each for what only it can do, while relishing the interaction and the challenge of the moments when the disciplines overlap and spark fascinating parallels and tensions. For example, for a lot of the last 150 years, there's been a lively debate about the question, where do we come from? One branch of science goes a very long way back and dwells on the nanoseconds surrounding the Big Bang. Another branch goes back to the beginning of life on Earth and the processes of evolution. These are gripping investigations. It's useless for theologians to claim they have an inside track on the truth or falsity of scientists' findings in such areas. Instead, theologians interrogate the scriptures to ask a related but different set of questions. One is, was it always in the mind and heart of God to be in relationship with creation and for that relationship to be focused by entering creation as a co-participant at some stage in the story? That's not a question science can answer, but it's hard to deny it's an exhilarating question to set alongside the others. Just imagine the attentiveness and absorption of God in beholding the evolution of creation, and awaiting the right time to enter it in order to be a co-participant with that part of it that could show some conscience and awareness in return. That's not a manipulative picture. That's a picture of astounding, patient, devoted, indescribable love. Here's a parallel question. It's fascinating to ask, where do we come from? But isn't it at least as interesting and perhaps more urgent to ask, where are we going? Theologians at this point hold no naive optimism that as a species or as a universe, we're intrinsically heading for Candyland. We're sinners as much as we've ever been, and we're no better or worse than our forebears or descendants. But Christian theology is committed to the notion of a sudden, final intervention of God in history that brings time to an end and inaugurates an era of glory and fulfillment. Most scientists keep a respectful silence on the question of where we're all going. But some of the new atheists fuse the theory of evolution with a notion of progress that suggests humans are heading for a happy place all on our own. That's why the new atheists are so cross with religion, because it's inhibiting our species' free ride to happiness. It's hard to fathom how you could live through the era of the gulags and the gas chambers and still believe in such a notion of progress. But that just shows how important the question of where we're going is. Scientists may disagree with the answers some theologians give, but the point is you can't avoid the question. And any answer to the question is going to depend on information science alone can't provide. Once you put these two questions together, where are we coming from and where are we going, you're into territory where science and theology can have a really interesting conversation. Now, the question is, what, if anything, is the logic at the heart of the universe? The Big Bang and evolution are huge contributions to science and philosophy. But here's the danger. Once you turn them uncritically into theology, as the new atheists tend to do, you get a single word answer. The logic of the universe is survival. Survival of each creature because death is the end, and survival of each species because extinction is forever. The whole dynamic of history mutates into survival. And adaptation that enables survival is what's known as progress. Conflict is the dynamic at the heart of every encounter, and survival is the reward for those who win the battle. But theology has a very different answer. Christians believe the logic, or the logos, or the word at the heart of the universe is not about survival. It's about death and resurrection. The ultimate future doesn't belong to those who've fought and prevailed. It belongs to those who've laid down their lives for others. This timeless logic is exemplified not in the species that survives, but in the single human being who accepted brutal execution and yet was raised to new life. The real Big Bang that dominates the Christian imagination is not the detonation that inaugurated the universe, but the rolling away of the stone that signaled the death of death. The real evolutionary pattern that baffles and amazes the Christian imagination is the history of humanity's extraordinary and elaborate hide-and-seek and somersaulting attempts to escape the logic of God's relentless, humble, sacrificial and limitless love, and the constant adaptation God makes to be present to us and in relationship with us anyway. Constant adaptation. That's a fascinating theme in evolutionary biology. That's a fascinating theme in ecology. That's a fascinating theme in climate studies. That's a fascinating theme in civil engineering. Constant adaptation. That's also a fascinating theme in the prophet Jeremiah. Jeremiah portrays God as a figure making constant adaptations. The vessel, observes Jeremiah, was spoiled in the potter's hands, and he reworked it into another vessel. This is the story of Israel. The vessel was broken, the covenant was spoiled, and God made something beautiful by fashioning it into a pot shaped around the Jew named Jesus. This is the story of Jesus. The vessel of Jesus, the body of Christ, was spoiled in the potter's hands, and God refashioned it into another vessel called the church, called you and me. This is the story of the church over and over. Our common life is spoiled and broken, and God refashions it into something old but new. This is your story. Your life was spoiled. Your pot was cracked. Your hopes were broken. Your plans were ruined. And God the potter made something that could never have been out of something that should never have been. Constant adaptation. That's not a disputed scientific theory. That's what Christians call the Holy Spirit. And this is why Christians honor and cherish and study natural science. Not just because science can solve things and find things and prove things and make things. All these are true, but they are simply to use science as a means to an end. If Christians are fully to embrace science, they must learn to enjoy science as an end in itself. In science, Christians can find a pattern and a logic with analogies and parallels to the very purpose of God. They can see depth and complexity and diversity and simplicity that together reflect the activity and character of God. They can see energy and creativity and adaptation that portray the dynamism of God. The study of science understood this way is nothing less than a form of prayer. It's an attempt to enter the presence and be enthralled by the mystery of the form and logic and wonder of all that is. Prayer. Scientists of Duke, be humble. Remember that science is an art, and that what you study is clay, being constantly fashioned and refashioned. Christians of Duke, be humbler still, and remember that science is a form of wonder, and that these scientists, if you let them, will teach you to wonder, to love, and to pray.
Now let us profess the statement of our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We will now have the mission announcement by David Allen, a member of chapel staff.
As we listen to the heart of God this morning, we can hear God grieving, especially with the people of Pakistan. Many have called the recent floods in that country the worst in their history. There has not been a single year since 2005 when Pakistan was not in some way affected by disaster. Earthquakes, flooding, massive displacement caused by political conflict, and one constant, drought and water shortages, which affect this nation's ability to feed itself. This morning, thousands of individuals remain stranded in inaccessible areas. Food shortages plague the country, while waterborne diseases are increasing rapidly in areas where people do not have access to safe drinking water. The entirety of this morning's undesignated offering will be sent to Church World Service, a trusted international relief partner, to support their large-scale response to the crisis in Pakistan. This is a moment where dire need calls for rapid response. We thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God of creation, you are the potter who reworks spoiled clay into another vessel. We bring to you those who struggle in starting anew, those re-entering the work field, and those re-entering society after a time in jail. Lord, rework these human vessels of clay as only you can into human works of art. Make vessels formed in your image, reshaped in your majesty. Clothe in your perfect cloth of love, peace, and kindness. Work not into perfection, but into faithfulness anew. Renew minds to know that you continually rework into new vessels as seems good to you. Rework hearts into vessels able to receive and give love as seems good to you. Fashion mouths into vessels of life and not death. Lord, let your will be done. Recycle our brokenness into a master's piece of true love and kindness. Lord, in your mercy. God of liberation, Paul makes an appeal that Philemon might return no longer a slave, but a beloved brother. Embolden your people with love for you and others. Strengthen within the desire to love more wholly and with greater honesty. Plead your case that we might seek to love you with greater intensity. Be with those who find it difficult to appeal in love, but often do so in anger. Encourage our hearts in leading from your love. Bind broken hearts that to be healed from injuries. Counteract counterproductive relationships. Love us that we might know how to love one another in spirit and in truth. Free those oppressed in human slavery today. Release those in spiritual and emotional bondage from the ties that entangle. Set captives free as only you can. We pray for those who slave away on low income and employers who seek to offer a living wage. Lord, in your mercy. God of transformation, in Christ, our master builder, you said a certain fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Strengthen us that we might be able to finish the good work that you have started in us. We pray for those still in recovery, physically, mentally, and emotionally after the tragedy of September 11th. Replenish the souls of those standing in the wake of the Pakistan floods. Reestablish the city in New Orleans as we stand 5 years after Hurricane Katrina. Continue with the rebuilding in Haiti. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. You will find in your bulletins a student interest card. This is an excellent way for chapel staff to get to know you better. It provides a way for you to express your interest in meeting with chapel staff, participating in worship, singing in the chapel choir, and even in getting involved in small groups or minority student ministries. So please fill this out and place it in the offering as it goes around. Now let us give unto God through our offering.
Thank you.
wonder-working God, we stand in awe of your marvelous works. We wonder at the depth and complexity and diversity and simplicity of your creation. The prophet Jeremiah and the psalmist remind us that you've known us in the most intimate ways even before our birth, and for this we praise you. We rejoice that you are constantly at work reshaping and reforming and renewing our lives when they are cracked, spoiled, and broken. We thank you for the administration of the university. We lift up their leadership and ask that you would continue to make the university thrive and grow under their guidance. Now bless the gifts we have given today. Shape them for your service at Duke, in Durham, and in the world. Make all of our resources instruments of your blessing in our world. In Jesus' name, amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. As a reminder, there will be Loco Pops on the lawn for university students following the service. May the potter's hands shape you and mold you by the power of the Holy Spirit into vessels of his love and peace. And may the blessings of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and always.